Hello everyone, I am Dr. Tejavati Nagaraj, Professor and Head, Department of Oral Medicine and Radiology, Sri Rajiv Gandhi College of Dental Sciences. Today I'll be discussing about the normal radiographic anatomical landmarks. Only when we know what is normal, we'll be able to know what are the pathologic findings. So today's class I'll be discussing about the normal radiographic anatomical landmarks of maxilla and mandible. Come to the first one, the teeth. A is enamel, B is dentin, C is pulp. The more calcified the structure, it appears more radio-opaque. So enamel, especially the surface enamel, is the most highly calcified tissue in the whole body. It appears radio-opaque. B is dentin. Dentin is slightly less mineralized than enamel, because of that it appears slightly less radio-opaque. And C is pulp. Pulp is a soft tissue and it appears radiolucent. Next is cervical burnout. Radiographs sometimes show diffuse radiolucent areas with ill-defined borders present on the mesial and distal aspects of the teeth in cervical region. These regions appear between the edge of the enamel cap and the crest of the alveolar ridge. It should not be confused with root caries. Lamina dura is a thin radio-opaque layer of dense bone surrounding the tooth socket. It is thicker than the surrounding trabecular bone, and thickness increases with increase in amount of the occlusal stress. In the first radiograph, you are able to see the lamina dura where the tooth is intact. The second one, it shows the lamina dura in a freshly extracted socket, healing socket. Alveolar crest. The gingival margin of the alveolar process that extends between the teeth is apparent on radiographs as radio-opaque line called alveolar crest. It is considered as normal if it is not more than 1.5 mm from the cemento-enamel junction of adjacent teeth. Periodontal ligament space. PDL space, or the periodontal ligament space, is primarily composed of collagen, so it appears as radiolucent space between the tooth root and the lamina dura. PDL space can be seen as a radiolucent line surrounding the roots of all the teeth. It appears between the tooth root and the lamina dura. Cancellous bone. It lies between the cortical plates in both the jaws. It is composed of thin radio-opaque plates and rods surrounding many small radiolucent marrow spaces. These are all the cancellous bone with marrow spaces. Coming to the landmarks of maxilla, we have median palatine suture, nasal fossa, nasal septum, nasal aperture, anterior nasal spine, incisive foramen, lateral fossa, maxillary sinus, maxillary tuberosity, and hamula process. Median palatine suture. It appears as a vertically oriented radiolucent line in true image projections through the midline, usually prominent between the two central incisors roots in young individuals. You'll find a thin radiolucent line between the roots of maxillary central incisors. It's a median palatine suture, appears radiolucent. Incisive foramen. The incisive foramen, also called the nasopalatine foramen or anterior palatine foramen in the maxilla, is the oral terminus of the nasopalatine canal. This canal originates in the anterior floor of the nasal fossa. The incisive foramen transmits the nasopalatine vessels and nerves. Nasal septum. The nasal septum is a bony vertical band-like midline suture structure that divides the nasal cavity into right and left chambers. The nasal septum is a radio-opaque landmark visible on the maxillary central periapicals. It appears as a radio-opaque structure above the apices of the roots of the maxillary central incisors in periapical radiographs. Nasal fossa. The nasal fossae appear as vertically oblong radiolucent structures bounded by bone. These structures can be seen on maxillary central incisor periapical views and partially on lateral incisor and canine periapicals. These are the nasal fossae. Nasal aperture. On periapical radiographs of the maxillary incisors, the inferior border of the fossa aperture appears as a radiopaque line extending bilaterally away from the base of the anterior nasal spine. Lateral fossa. The radiolucency represents a depression above and posterior to the lateral incisor. It's the lateral fossa appears radiolucent. Anterior nasal spine. The anterior nasal spine is most frequently demonstrated on periapical radiographs of the maxillary central incisors located in the midline. It lies approximately 1.5 to 2 cm above the alveolar crest, usually at or just below the junction of the inferior end of the nasal septum and the inferior outline of the nasal aperture. Nose. The soft tissue of the tip of the nose is frequently seen in projections of the maxillary central and lateral incisors superimposed over the roots of these teeth. The image of the nose has a uniform, slightly opaque appearance with sharp borders. Nasolacrimal canal. The nasal and maxillary bones form the nasolacrimal canal. It runs from the medial aspect of the anteroinferior border of the orbit inferiorly to drain under the inferior concha of the nasal cavity. It's an occlusal radiograph, maxillary cross-sectional occlusal radiograph. You are able to see the nasolacrimal canals. Maxillary sinus. The maxillary sinus with its thin bony walls, its thin mucosa and its vast air space produce an extremely dark image deep to the maxillary teeth. Its outlines, particularly its floor, are clearly delineated by delicate radio-opaque lines. Maxillary sinus. The anterior border of the maxillary sinus, the white arrows, crosses the floor of the nasal fossa, which is the shown by black arrow. In general, the floor of the sinus is approximately coincidental with the location of the apices of the roots of the upper teeth, that is bicuspids and the first two molars. But often, as much as 2 or even 3 mm of maxillary bone between the root ends and the sinus floor. You'll find 2 to 3 millimeters of the bone. Maxillary sinus. The floor of the maxillary sinus often extends towards the crest of the alveolar ridge in response to the missing teeth. In the first radiograph A, you are able to see the maxillary sinus, floor of the maxillary sinus right above the roots of the teeth. Whereas in the next one, B, you are able to see the floor of the maxillary sinus in an edentulous ridge. Maxillary sinus septa. Septa, that is the arrow in the maxillary sinus, it's formed by a low ridge of bone on the sinus wall. It's a maxillary posterior radiograph. Zygomatic process and zygoma. The zygomatic process of the maxilla is an extension of the lateral maxillary sinus surface that arises in the region of the apices of the first and second molars and articulates with the maxillary process of the zygoma. The zygomatic process of the maxilla protrudes laterally from the maxillary walls. Its size may be quite variable, small with thick borders or large with thin borders. zygomatic process and zygoma. The inferior border of the zygoma extends posteriorly from the inferior portion of the zygomatic process of the maxilla. Nasolabial fold, an oblique line demarcating a region that appears to be covered by a veil of slight radio opacity, frequently traverses periapical radiographs of the premolar region. The line of contrast is sharp and the area of increased radio opacity is posterior to the line. Pterygoid plates. The medial and lateral pterygoid plates lie immediately posterior to the tuberosity of the maxilla. The image of these two plates is extremely variable and they do not appear at all on many intraoral radiographs of the third molar area. Hamillar process. It's a bony spine extending from pterygoid process of the sphenoid bone. It appears as a radio opaque spine that is recorded on radiographs distal to the tuberosity of the maxilla and extends downwards. Landmarks of mandible, symphysis, lingual foramen, genial tubercles, mental ridge, mental foramen, mental fossa, external oblique line, internal oblique line, mylohyoid line, mandibular foramen, inferior alveolar canal, submandibular gland fossa, and nutrient canals. Coming to symphysis. Radiographs of the region of the mandibular symphysis in infants demonstrate a radiolucent line through the midline of the jaw between the images of the forming deciduous central incisors. This suture usually fuses by the end of the first year of life, after which it is no longer radiographically apparent. We should not confuse it with a fracture line. Lingual foramen. It is set in the midline, deep to the apices of the anterior teeth. It appears as a small radiolucent dot at the symphysis area, usually surrounded by a radio-opaque structure. Genial tubercles. The genial tubercles, also called the mental spine, are located on the lingual surface of the mandible, slightly above the inferior border and in the midline. They are bony protuberances, more or less spine-shaped, that often are divided into right and left prominence and a superior and inferior prominence. Genial tubercles appear as radio-opaque circle that surrounds the lingual foramen just below the apices of the incisors. Mental ridge. It is a bony prominence found on the labial aspect of the mandible near its inferior border and extended from the premolar region to the symphysis. On periapical radiographs of the mandibular central incisors, the mental ridge, that the protuberance, may occasionally be seen as two radio-opaque lines sweeping bilaterally forward and upwards towards the midline. Mental fossa. The mental fossa is a depression on the labial aspect of the mandible extending laterally from the midline and above the mental ridge. The resultant radiolucency may be mistaken for pathology. Mental foramen. The mental foramen is usually the anterior limit of the inferior dental canal that is apparent on periapical radiographs. Its image is quite variable and it may be identified only about half of the time because the opening of the mental canal is directed superiorly and posteriorly. Next is mandibular canal. The radiographic image of the mandibular canal is a dark linear shadow with thin radio-opaque superior and inferior borders cast by the lamella of bone that bounds the canal. The mandibular canal in A on the periapical view The arrows denote radio-opaque superior and inferior cortical borders. B is cone beam section through the body of the mandible. It's a different patient, shows corticated borders of the mandibular canal. C is cone beam cross-sectional view, shows the circular mandibular canal with corticated borders lying adjacent to the lingual plate. Next is myelohyoid ridge. The myelohyoid ridge, also called the internal oblique ridge, is a slightly irregular crest of bone on the lingual surface of the mandibular body. Its anterior margin lies about 10 mm inferior to the alveolar ridge, lingual to the second premolar, and extends posteriorly to the area of the third molar about 5 mm below the alveolar crest. Next is myelohyoid ridge. This ridge serves as an attachment for the myelohyoid muscle. Submandibular gland fossa. On the lingual surface of the mandibular body, immediately below the myelohyoid ridge in the molar region, there is frequently a depression in the bone. This concavity accommodates the submandibular gland and often appears as a radiolucent area with the sparse trabecular pattern characteristic of the region. External oblique ridge. The external oblique ridge is a continuation of the anterior border of the mandibular ramus. It follows an anteroinferior course lateral to the alveolar process. It is relatively prominent in its upper part and juts considerably on the outer surface of the mandible in the region of the third molar. This bony elevation gradually flattens and usually disappears at about where the alveolar process and mandible join below the first molar. Inferior border of the mandible. Occasionally, the inferior mandibular border is seen on periapical projections as a characteristically dense, broad, radio-opaque band of bone. Coronoid process. The image of the coronoid process of the mandible is frequently apparent on periapical radiographs of the maxillary molar region as a triangular radio opacity with its apex directed superiorly and anteriorly, superimposed on the region of the third molar. Restorative materials. Restorative materials vary in their radiographic appearance, depending primarily on the thickness, density, and atomic number. Of these, the atomic number is most influential. The first radiograph shows the silver amalgam restoration. The second radiograph shows the stainless steel pins. The third radiograph is a cast gold bridge. And the fourth radiograph shows you the restorative material with its base. Same thing, the restorative materials. Silver amalgam restoration first, second is the stainless steel pins, third is the cast gold bridge, fourth is the restorative material with base material. This is again the gutta percha cone. It's an endodontically treated tooth wherein it appears radio opaque. Gutta percha cones in the root canal. Thank you.